Hey everybody, and welcome to this special episode of The Critical Reel, the podcast that ranks James Bond movies from worst to best, and also takes movies from the week, breaks them open, and reviews them. But I'm not reviewing a movie on this episode of The Critical Reel, because this is a special episode of The Critical Reel. This is an episode where I'm not going to dissect the movie, I'm not going to review it, I'm going to rank all 24 James Bond movies from worst to best, because this is James Bond week on The Critical Reel. Now, just last Monday, my brother and I, we reviewed Spectre, which is the new James Bond movie, and if you haven't listened to that episode yet, I suggest you do it. You can find it pretty much anywhere. You can find it on iTunes, you can find it at thecriticalreel.com, you can find it on YouTube. That's our latest podcast episode, so I suggest you go listen to that episode if you haven't already. It's where we dissect and review Spectre, which just came out last week all across Australia. And I'm not going to tell you what I thought about that movie, because you should just go and listen to the episode. And so following up on the episode about Spectre, I decided to do a special episode, which is this episode, all about James Bond. This is the 53rd anniversary of James Bond. I can't believe he's been around for 53 years. And I just thought it'd be appropriate to rank all 24 movies. And this ranking is, it's a very personal list, as any list should be. I think any list that someone makes should be a personal list. So I'm not going for the objective kind of expected approach. You know, I'm not going to go Goldfinger is the best because everybody loves Goldfinger and Goldfinger is iconic. And, you know, or I'm not going to put Dr. No as the best because it's the first movie. It's a personal list. I'm going based on my personal preferences to the James Bond movies. So if you disagree, you know, too bad. It's my list, but you can always let me know if you disagree, and we can have a chat about why you disagree with some of my choices and where you think my choices should end up. Before I start the list, though, I just want to remind you guys that you can find me on all the social medias out there. You can find me on Facebook at facebook.com/thecriticalreel. You can find me on Twitter at thecriticalreel. Visit thecriticalreel.com to see more about what I'm about. Visit Hooked on Film, which is a Perth-based up-and-coming film magazine. I write for them. We do movie reviews. We do opinion pieces. We do lists. We do all kinds of things. So go and check out Hooked on Film. And if you're listening to me on iTunes, which you shouldn't be for this episode because this episode is not going on iTunes, but if you are so inclined to follow me on iTunes, please don't forget to subscribe to my iTunes channel. Rate and review my channel, I beg of you, and download my episodes. Take me wherever you go. So don't forget, you can find me on social media if you want to have a chat, if you want to contact me, if you want to request a movie to review, by all means. If you want to request another one of these kinds of episodes, that's even better. Like, so if you want to request a list episode or a ranking episode, a top 5, a top 10 episode, whatever that is, just contact me on social media. Let me know and I can produce more of these episodes for you guys. Because I have fun compiling these lists and I have fun talking to you about them. So yeah, just hit me up if you want more of this stuff. Okay, so all the boring stuff now is out of the way. I can actually start the list proper because I've got 24 films to get through. 24 films, and I'm trying to do it in under an hour, so I think I can easily do it in under an hour. I don't think I'm going to go overtime like we did last week for Spectre. We went way overtime last week. I think that episode was like a 1 hour and 20 minutes long, which is just insanely long to talk about one movie. So I'm going to try and keep this episode to under an hour. I don't think I'm going to have much of a problem because I'm not going to give you a review per se of each episode. I'm just going to give you a few facts about the episode and then a brief explanation as to why that movie ended up in that spot on the list. Does it make sense? I think that makes sense to me. I have to say though, watching, like, I watched all 24 films. I did like a Bond marathon about a couple of years ago. And that experience is a very interesting experience. If you haven't done a Bond marathon to watch all 23 movies, I'm saying 23, not 24, because Spectre is not out on video yet. So if you ever do a Bond marathon to see all 23 Bond movies, you know, back to back, it is a very interesting experience. It's like stepping into a time capsule and being with this character James Bond over the course of 5 decades. It's quite an experience because you get to see how the character and the situation and everything about the James Bond mythos, how all that changes as the decades progress. You know, you've got 60s Bond, you've got 70s Bond, 80s Bond, 90s Bond, 2000s Bond, and 2010s Bond. It's a very interesting experience. I suggest you do it if you have the time to see all 23 movies back to back. I did that a couple of years ago. And I'm saying this because that kind of influenced a lot of my opinions about the movie. So movies that the general public deems to be horrible, to me, I might not find horrible, because in the context of watching the movies back to back, in the context of that particular movie sitting in between its predecessor and its successor, I kind of relate it to that and form my own opinions of it, if that makes sense. So like I said, it's my list. You can't do anything about it. You're not going to change my list. It's my list. But, you know, there might be a few ranking choices that you disagree with. Like I said, just let me know. Let me know if you disagree and we can have a chat about it. That's pretty much what this whole episode is for. It's trying to get a discussion going. So I'm rambling on very much. I'm going to get the list going. I've kind of unofficially segmented the list into like four different segments, because I kind of realized that that's... When I ranked this list, I kind of realized that that's how the segments came about, just like spontaneously. It starts off, and this is kind of a spoiler to the list because I haven't started the list yet, but I'm giving away a couple of hints. It starts off with what I call the unfortunate Roger Moore section, because all the worst movies, all the worst James Bond movies are from Roger Moore. Sad to say, I'm sorry, Roger Moore. You know, you make a relatively good Bond, but you have produced some of the worst Bond movies. Well, you haven't produced, the company produced, but you were starring in some of the worst Bond movies. So it starts off with the unfortunate Roger Moore section, and then there's the forgettable but otherwise harmless middle section, where they're really a string of forgettable Bond movies, but they're harmless, so they're neither good nor bad, but you just don't remember them well enough. Then comes the good section. So just a short series of good Bond movies. And then the outstanding section, which is the crème of the crop, which is, I'm guessing, the top five or the top seven, maybe, which is the outstanding section. So just to let you know, that's how I've kind of segmented this list. And I'm going to start the list. So kicking off my Bond ranking list is A View to a Kill. A View to a Kill came out in 1985. It was directed by John Glenn. The villain is Max Zorin, played quite wonderfully by Christopher Walken. The Bond girls, well, they're two... Okay, most of these movies have multiple villains and multiple Bond girls. I kind of choose like the most prominent ones, except for a couple of instances. This is one of those instances where the Bond girls are Stacey Sutton, played by Tanya Roberts, and Mayday, played by Grace Jones. Now, Mayday is not necessarily a Bond girl in that she's Bond's psychic. She's more of the femme fatale in this movie. But I mentioned her here because I'm going to talk about her a little later on. The theme song for A View to Kill is A View to a Kill by Duran Duran. Bond investigates a drugged horse racing scandal and is led to Max Zorin, an eccentric industrialist who plans to destroy Silicon Valley so that he can create a monopoly on microchip technologies. The chase leads Bond to the Eiffel Tower and a blimp ride that eclipses in a tense climax atop the Golden Gate Bridge. That synopsis just made the movie sound more exciting than it is, because it's not a tense climax, it's a stupid climax, and this is a stupid movie. I mean, this is, sad to say, like I said, a lot of the Roger Moore movies are just stupid. This is one of them. And the reason, like, this movie was fighting with the number 23 spot, so the second last spot, you know, it was fighting with that movie for last place. And the reason I gave it to A View to a Kill is because Roger Moore is just too old in this movie. This was Roger Moore's last movie. It was in 1985. He was pushing 60. He looks like a grandfather in this movie. I'm not even kidding. He looks like a granddad. And it's just awkward to see him in the romance scenes. It's just unbelievable to see him in the stunt scenes. This movie opens up with an ice skiing scene where he's just doing these crazy stunts on ice skis. And there is no way Roger Moore is doing those stunts. There's no way Roger Moore's James Bond is doing those stunts. I'm not going to believe it. You know, there are scenes where he's hanging from the ladder of a fire engine, and he's like dangling over oncoming traffic, and he jumps on a drawbridge and pulls himself up with just his arms. Who's going to believe that Roger Moore, looking like he does in this movie, is going to do all those stunts? And that, for me, just makes this one of the worst Bond movie, because I think Eon Productions should have realized that their actor who's playing Bond was just getting too old. They should have cast someone else. They should have they should have done something about it, but they let Roger Moore do it, and I don't think he was happy about it. And yeah, this is just, it's just the worst. Like I said, there was a stupid plot. I hate the fact that they use California Girls from the Beach Boys in the opening scene. That was just a ridiculous music choice. And they do it so many times in the Roger Moore movies. Like, they try and... The whole Roger Moore period, I think, was just an attempt by Eon Productions to lighten the mood, because I think they went, you know, rather dark with, I say rather dark, but not really, with the Sean Connery movies, and even with the George Lazenby movie. So I think they wanted to lighten the mood, which they just went about doing in the wrong way. And the reason I mentioned Mayday earlier was because Mayday just makes a very awkward Bond girl. Like, she's just this very weird character. And it's not, like, I'm not putting Grace Jones down. Like, she does, I think she's a great singer and she's good at what she does, but she just makes a very odd Bond girl. And that's why I mentioned her, because she just adds to the movie's weirdness. At number 23 is Moonraker, another Roger Moore movie. This was in 1979, directed by Lewis Gilbert. The villain is Hugo Drax, played by Michael Lonsdale. The Bond girl is Holly Goodhead. That's a great name. Played by Lois Childs. I'm assuming it's Childs. The song is Moonraker by Dame Shirley Bassey. A space shuttle on loan to MI6 by Hugo Drax is hijacked in midair. Bond is sent to investigate Drax on the pretense of an official apology. Bond discovers that Drax hijacked the shuttle himself and stumbles upon a secret lab with fatal poisons. Drax plans to create a space colony and commit a global genocide to regenerate a perfect species. How stupid does that sound? This plot, this movie, is just ridiculous. I mean, this, like I said, this could easily have been the worst Bond movie, but I had to give it to A View to Kill because of Roger Moore's age in that movie. This movie, it has such a stupid plot. And the whole reason this movie existed in 1979 was it was just cashing in on the success of Star Wars. Because Star Wars came out 2 years earlier and just completely revolutionized the blockbuster kind of movie. It revolutionized science fiction. And you know, the Eon Productions must have thought, okay, look, 20th Century Fox can do wonderful things with science fiction and the blockbuster movie with Star Wars. Why can't we do the same with Moonraker? You know, we've got a bigger budget, we've got bigger stars, let's just do it. And then they completely messed it up. There's a really stupid sequence in Venice where Bond is on a gondola, and the gondola becomes a hovercraft and he goes on land, and there's this ridiculous and inexplicable shot of a pigeon doing a double take as it sees Bond, you know, zooming by on the gondola. The zero gravity scenes in this movie are just ridiculous. I mean, you can totally see that that all the actors are just moving in fake slow motion, that there is no effort whatsoever to make it seem like they're in zero gravity. And that just leads to horrible action sequences. This is a horrible movie. That's pretty much all I can say about it. It's a horrible movie. At number 22 is For Your Eyes Only, another Roger Moore movie. This was in 1981, directed by John Glenn. The villain is Aristotle Christatos. I'm assuming that's it. Played by Julian Glover, who you will recall from Indiana Jones and The Last Crusade. You also recall him from Star Wars: The Empire Strikes Back, and you will recall him more familiarly as what's his name? As Grand Maester Pycelle from Game of Thrones. Yep, that's it. Julian Glover. So he plays a villain in For Your Eyes Only. The Bond girl is Melina Havelock, played by Carol Bouquet. The theme song is For Your Eyes Only by Sheena Easton. A ship containing an automatic targeting attack communicator, also known as ATAC or ATAC, which can control ballistic missile attacks, is sunk. Bond is sent to retrieve the ATAC, before the Russians do. MI6 had sent archaeologist Timothy Havelock to discreetly locate the ship, but he and his wife were murdered in front of their daughter Melina. Bond tracks down their killer Hector Gonzalez and must complete his work before Melina takes her revenge. That actually mentions nothing about Aristotle Christatos as a villain, but I don't really care. This is just a really dull and forgettable movie. Like, I don't think there's anything of note about this movie whatsoever. And it was just a ridiculous opening scene where and it's not even like linked to the rest of the movie. The scene at the start of the movie is just Bond or Blofeld attacking Bond with a helicopter, remote control helicopter, and then Bond takes over the helicopter and dunks Blofeld down like a huge chimney chute. It's just a stupid opening scene. It's just, what is it doing there? It's not even funny. It doesn't do anything. Blofeld, you don't even see Blofeld's face. What is the whole point of that scene? It's just, it shouldn't be there. And I just don't like the fact that, I can't remember the name of that bimbo ice skater that's in the movie, and she just tries to be all cozy with Bond, and Bond is old enough to be a granddad. The whole movie is just completely forgettable. And it's just another one of those bad Roger Moore movies. At number 21, finally, is not a Roger Moore movie. It's Diamonds Are Forever. This was in 1971, directed by Guy Hamilton. The villain was Blofeld, Ernst Stavro Blofeld, played by Charles Grey. The Bond girl is Tiffany Case, played by Jill St. John. The theme song is Diamonds Are Forever by Shirley Bassey. MI6 arrests small-time smuggler Peter Franks, and Bond, played by Sean Connery, takes his place, meeting courier Tiffany Case. He follows the trail of the diamonds as everyone who touches them gets killed. The end of the pipeline is Blofeld, with another plan for world domination. And his plan for world domination involves him wanting to use diamonds to construct some kind of space laser thing. This movie is at number 21 because Sean Connery, first of all, was way too old to be Bond by this point. And secondly, this movie is just incredibly comical. And not intentionally. There are these two characters, and they're like, I don't really know what they are. They're like hitmen of sorts. They're called Mr. Wint and Mr. Kidd. Their dialogue is atrocious. Their acting is comical. Their two characters are written into the story to provide some kind of comic relief and to appear dangerous, but they achieve neither. Also, it's just embarrassing to see Blofeld in drag. Like, you actually see Charles Grey as Blofeld in drag at one point in this movie. There's a really silly gymnastics fight where Bond fights these two gymnastic chicks, and they're like swinging around and like kicking him in the gut. The only good thing in this movie is that there's a car chase, and the car chase is actually quite well choreographed. It reminded me of the car chase in Jack Reacher, which, by the way, is a movie that I really liked, and most people don't. So Diamonds Are Forever is by far and away the worst Sean Connery movie, and it stands at number 21 on my list. At number 20, we are going back to Roger Moore, Octopussy, in 1983. Probably the worst-titled Bond movie, next to Quantum of Solace. Directed by John Glenn, the villains are General Orlov, played by Steven Berkoff, and Kamal Khan, played by Louis Jourdan. I'm Louis Jourdan? I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. The Bond girl is Octopussy, played by Maud Adams, and you will realize that Maud Adams starred again in the Bond movie, in The Man with the Golden Gun, but she played a different character. The theme song is All Time High by Rita Coolidge. Agent 009 is stabbed and crashes through a window of the British Embassy in Berlin, holding a forged Fabergé egg. Bond is sent to investigate and begins at the Sotheby's auction for the real Fabergé counterpart. 007 is led to India, finding corrupt Prince Kamal Khan and his beautiful associate, Octopussy. Yeah, this movie is not... it's not the worst. Obviously, it's not the worst Roger Moore movie. There are pockets of good moments in this... off the top of my head, I can't really name any. I've only seen this movie twice, and it was quite a long time ago. The worst part of this movie would have to be Bond dressed as a clown towards the end of the movie, during the climax of the movie. He dresses as a clown to thwart General Orlov's plan, master plan. No one wants to see Bond dressed as a clown. No one. So that's all I have to say about Octopussy. Not the worst Roger Moore, but it stands at number 20. At number 19, Die Another Day. This was in 2002, directed by Lee Tamahori. The villain is Gustav Graves, played by Toby Stevens. The Bond girl is Giacinta Jinx Johnson, just call it Jinx, played by Halle Berry. The song is Die Another Day by Madonna, probably one of the worst Bond theme songs. I'm sorry, you know, it's... first of all, I don't like Madonna, and this song is just downright ridiculous. Bond is betrayed during a mission in North Korea and is captured and tortured for 14 months. After revealing nothing, Bond is released in a deal with MI6, who release a terrorist in return. Bond escapes from MI6 to find the traitor and kill the terrorist he was traded for. Yeah, I think we've just passed the unfortunate Roger Moore section. We just entered the forgettable but otherwise harmless middle section. This is one of those movies, it's neither here nor there, it's just there, and It is what it is. What I did like about this movie, though, was the fact that it includes a reference to every single previous Bond movie. Unfortunately, I don't have the list of every single reference up to this point, because Die Another Day came out in 2002. That was the 40th anniversary of James Bond, so they thought, as a tribute to James Bond, they're going to include a reference to every previous James Bond movie. So there's like a scene where Jinx is tied up to like this device and there are lasers shooting all over the place. That's a reference to Goldfinger. There's a scene where Jinx emerges from the ocean and she's wearing like this red bikini with this kind of utility belt. That is a reference to Dr. No, when Ursula Andress emerges in that iconic shot, and she's kind of wearing the exact same bikini but just a different color, including the utility belt. So it's just stuff like that. They just have references to every Bond movie before. The really stupid parts about this movie was the fact that they had an invisible car, which, you know, I think just dips a bit too much into the science fiction aspect. It kind of loses, you know, the grounded reality that a lot of the other James Bond movies had. A lot, I don't say all. I think Jinx was just a very underwhelming Bond girl, even though Halle Berry is incredibly attractive. The fencing sword fight scene, I thought, just went on for way too long and was completely unnecessary. You know, it's just men being men and wanting to fight. So Die Another Day is number 19. Moving on to number 18 is Thunderball, 1965, directed by Terence Young. The villain is Emilio Largo, played by Adolfo Celli. The Bond girl is Domino Derval, played by Claudine Alga. The song is Thunderball by Tom Jones. Emilio Largo, the number two at Spectre, has stolen two nuclear warheads. He threatens to destroy a city in the United States and England unless a large ransom is paid. Bond is sent to the Bahamas to investigate. Yeah, this is just a very forgettable movie. I mean, just listening to that synopsis alone doesn't fill anyone with any excitement. This was sad, though, because this was just after Goldfinger. It was literally a year after Goldfinger, and it kind of, you know, tuned down the James Bond movie. This movie was also known for a lot of its underwater scenes, and that was like the first time, you know, any major film had done such extensive scenes underwater, completely underwater, with cameras and stunt crews and actors all underwater. A lot of those scenes, while, you know, good, and I can see the reasons why those scenes were there, because, you know, they realized that they were the first ones who were doing it, a lot of them are just incredibly boring and long. They're just overdrawn scenes, and for most of the time, you can't follow the action. Like, you have no idea who's fighting who and who's who, and like, what is going on. You just have no idea. Like, the fighting scenes underwater are just incredibly confusing. So that adds to Thunderball's mediocrity. Number 17. Quantum of Solace. 2008, directed by Mark Forster. The villain is Dominic Green, played by Matthew Amalric. The Bond girl is Camille Montez, played by Olga Kurylenko, and I'm pretty sure I said that correctly as an English person can say that name. The theme song is Another Way to Die by Jack White and Alicia Keys, and in my opinion, this is probably the worst James Bond theme song. It's not even a song. If you listen to this song, the theme song, Another Way to Die, it is so disjointed, it is so awkward, it is so, it lacks so much chemistry between Jack White and Alicia Keys. It's not even a song. And when you make this a James Bond song, it becomes even worse. I think Jack White and Alicia Keys, they're not a good match because they're two completely different singers and they bring different styles to the game. It's the worst James Bond theme song. And I think no one remembers this song. In a continuation from Casino Royale, Bond is set to eliminate Dominic Green, a wealthy businessman who is trying to control the water supply of Bolivia to extort its government. He also seeks to avenge the death of Vespa Lind. If you don't know who Vespa Lind is, don't worry, we will come to that. And I think, like I said, together with the theme song, this movie just, I think, has fallen into a black hole. I think most people forget that Quantum of Solace even exists. I'm not even kidding. Like, I think even in Spectre, now if you go back and listen to my Spectre review, I didn't mention this in the episode though, but in Spectre there are a couple of references to like the past Daniel Craig Bond movies. And like, I don't recall them mentioning Quantum of Solace at all. I think they might have mentioned it once, like the Quantum Organization or something. But I think even the writers of Spectre just completely pushed Quantum of Solace into this abyss, you know, and just sent it on its way and just never wanted to think of it again. How many of you, like, even remember Quantum of Solace? How many people even remember watching Quantum of Solace? You probably saw it and completely forgot everything that happened in it. It's just one of those movies that has fallen into a black hole, and that's because it's bad. In this movie, Bond becomes an action hero, which is why, while, you know, while it's not as bad as some of the other movies that I mentioned, it still finds itself at number 17 because it makes James Bond into an action hero. And he's not an action hero. James Bond, you know, does not fall through glass and, like, dangle from ropes and, like, wrestle with guys all over the place. He is a suave assassin who occasionally gets into fights. You know, for him, violence is a chore. It's a nuisance. He doesn't want it in his life. And I swear, I think this movie might be the only Bond movie to include a foot chase, a car chase, a bike chase, a plane chase, and a boat chase. It has literally every single chase you can think of in this one movie. And that's because they decided to make Bond an action hero, which he is not. At number 16 is On Her Majesty's Secret Service, 1969, the only George Lazenby James Bond movie. Directed by Peter Hunt, the villain is, once again, Ernst Stavro Blofeld, played by Telly Savalas. The Bond girl is Teresa Di Vincenzo, played by Diana Rigg, who a lot of you will recall as a much older woman in Game of Thrones, as she plays the matriarch of the Martell family. No, wait. No, not the Martell family, the Tyrells, that's right. Diana Rigg, the Bond girl in this movie, plays the matriarch of the Tyrell house in Game of Thrones, in case you didn't know. The theme song is instrumental. It's a very good theme song, actually. It's just the James Bond theme, kind of tweaked for the movie. Bond rescues the suicidal Tracy DiVincenzo and is brought at gunpoint to meet her father, Marc-Ange Draco. Probably pronouncing that wrong. The head of one of the largest criminal organizations in Europe. Draco strikes a deal with Bond, agreeing to reveal the location of Blofeld if Bond will look after his daughter. Gah, that... Yeah. I mean, the only thing of note in this movie is that Bond almost gets married. That is the only thing of note in this movie. I mean, it's a very confused movie. Like, I think it confuses its tone now and again. I think, you know, Lazenby is trying to be a funny Bond, but he's not a funny Bond. The plot is kind of interesting, but doesn't quite get there. And it's just, I don't think this movie is as bad as everyone thinks it is. You know, everyone thinks, oh, it's horrible because Lazenby was a horrible Bond. He's not that bad. He's an awkward Bond, but he's not a terrible Bond. And yeah, it's just not as bad as everyone thinks it is. I remember having 50% half the fond memories of this movie than I think most people did. Number 15. The Living Daylights, 1987. This was the first Timothy Dalton Bond movie. Directed by John Glenn, the villain is Brad Whitaker, played by Joe Don Baker, who returns in GoldenEye and Tomorrow Never Dies, playing a different character. The Bond girl is Cara Millovi, played by Miriam Diabo. The theme song is The Living Daylights by A-ha, one of the better James Bond theme songs, I think, and quite underrated. I quite enjoy the song. Bond is assigned to protect Georgi Koskov. Probably pronouncing that wrong, but I don't care. An ex-KGB officer who is defecting to the British. Koskov is to escape during the intermission at the Bratislava Concert Hall and must be protected from a KGB sniper. Bond sets up across the street but decides against assassinating the sniper when he realizes she is an amateur woman. This movie is just extremely forgettable. I can't even tell you anything about the plot because I can't remember it. All I can remember is that there might be some double agent or some double crossing going on. The Bond girl is incredibly annoying and very dull. This whole movie is just, yeah, I'm moving on. Number 14, Live and Let Die. This was Roger Moore's first time out as Bond, 1973, directed by Guy Hamilton once again. The villain is Dr. Kananga, played by Yaphet Kotto. The Bond girl is Solitaire, played by Jane Seymour. The theme song is Live and Let Die by Paul McCartney and the Wings. And I want to say something about this theme song because everyone loves this theme song. When people talk about their favorite James Bond theme songs, a lot of them mention Live and Let Die. I don't think it is. For me, The James Bond theme song has to sound like a James Bond theme song. And there's a whole stretch in the 1980s where all the theme songs were just very generic love ballads and none of them sounded like a theme song. Live and Let Die, while it's not a love ballad, it doesn't sound like a James Bond theme song. You know, there's that whole stretch in the song where it just doesn't suit. It's a good song, but it's not a good James Bond song. And that's all I have to say about Live and Let Die. Several British agents are killed in a short period of time during routine surveillance of dictator Dr. Kananga. Bond is sent to New York to investigate and falls into a trap of gangster Mr. Big, thanks to his psychic tarot card reader, Solitaire. It's a very silly idea. Solitaire is not a very interesting Bond girl. But what is interesting about Live and Let Die, it's the blaxploitation Bond movie. I mean, this was the early 70s where blaxploitation was a big thing. And I think Eon Productions just decided to make one of their movies a blaxploitation movie. And I think they chose that particular time in the history of the world to make it. But it's still a very forgettable movie. The thing I remember most about this movie is the opening where there's like this parade down the streets of New Orleans and like the band is playing and the band is playing and then these guys carry a coffin and they murder one of these like secret agents and the coffin kind of just drops over the body and picks it up and then they just carry on down in the parade as if nothing happened. That is what I remember most about this movie, along with Roger Moore's kind of iconic Bond costume later on in the movie where he wears the black turtleneck with the gun holster. It's a forgettable movie despite what except for the parts that I mentioned, so yeah, Live and Let Die. Number 13, You Only Live Twice, 1967, directed by Lewis Gilbert. The villain is once again Ernst Stavro Blofeld, played by Donald Pleasance, which a lot of you guys will remember from Halloween, where he played the very venerable Dr. Loomis. The Bond girl is Kissy Suzuki, played by Mie Hama. The theme song is You Only Live Twice by Nancy Sinatra. See, again, You Only Live Twice, that's one of those like love ballad songs that doesn't really fit as a Bond song. Ernst Stavro Blofeld is hijacking American and Russian space shuttles in an attempt to start a war between the two nations. Bond is sent to Japan to investigate with the help of Taiga Tanaka, the head of station in Tokyo. Armed with over 100 trained ninjas, Bond infiltrates Blofeld's volcano lair. This is a movie that a lot of people will kind of realize is the movie that inspired Austin Powers, because the look of Dr. Evil is based on Donald Pleasance's look as Blofeld, and the whole, you know, hollowed out volcano lair with all the henchmen running around trying to look busy. It's all borrowed very heavily from this movie. But this movie is incredibly racist. It is incredibly racist. I mean, there's a part in the movie where Sean Connery is meant to look like a Japanese guy, and they kind of slit his eyes and give him this dorky wig, and it's just so insulting to Asian people. And it's a silly movie. It's just very, very silly. But for me, this is the quintessential Blofeld movie. Partly because it was so popular that it inspired Austin Powers, but partly because you get to see Blofeld, you get to see his power, you get to see the magnitude of his organization in Spectre with the whole hollowed out volcano lair. You know, and there's a few explosive action scenes in the volcano lair. And like I said, it just highlights the sheer force of Spectre. I mean, the fact that they gave Spectre this bombastic hideout, you know, just adds to the movie's charm, even though it is incredibly racist. All right, we've reached the halfway point of this list. It's taken me a while, but I hope you guys are still with me, and I hope you guys are still interested to find out what my top half of this list is. You know, are you agreeing with me so far with my bottom half of the list? You know, are there any movies that you would have pushed into the top half? Let me know. Moving on. Number 12, The Man with the Golden Gun, 1974. Roger Moore is James Bond, directed by Guy Hamilton. The villain is Francisco Scaramanga, played by Christopher Lee. The Bond girl is Mary Goodnight, played by Britt Eklund, who also starred with Christopher Lee in The Wicker Man. Interesting fun fact, and The Wicker Man is a fantastic movie. Go see The Wicker Man if you haven't, the original one, not the remake with Nicolas Cage. The theme song is The Man with the Golden Gun by Lulu, and this, for me, also is one of the worst Bond theme songs, because the lyrics... Have you... Sit down and listen to the lyrics of The Man with the Golden Gun. The lyrics, I swear, are written by a 2-year-old kid, maybe a 5-year-old. They're the most juvenile, obvious, lazy lyrics I've ever heard in a James Bond song. And it's just a stupid song. It's a stupid song. Why are they, you know, exalting the villain in this movie and in this song? I don't get it. MI6 is sent a golden bullet with 007 engraved onto it. M fears that Bond will be assassinated by Francisco Scaramanga, the $1 million a shot hitman known for his golden gun, and sends Bond to find him first. This is a pretty good movie. This is a pretty good James Bond movie. I mean, it starts off with a solid opening scene, and it ends with a kind of mirrored scene in like this funhouse type place in Scaramanga's hideout. It's a relatively good movie. I think Christopher Lee makes a splendid villain as Scaramanga, and he's one of the Bond villains that most people remember, and for good reason. And there's also a pretty cool MI6 hideout in this movie, which is in a sunken ship. And it's interesting because all the walls of the hideout are slanted because the ship is kind of tilted in the water, but all the floors are straight. I thought that was an interesting MI6 hideout. So yeah, Man with the Golden Gun starts off in the second half of my list in a reasonable fashion. Number 11, Tomorrow Never Dies, 1997, Pierce Brosnan as James Bond, directed by Roger Spottiswoode. The villain is Elliot Carver, played by Jonathan Pryce. The Bond girl is Wai Lin, played by Michelle Yeoh. The theme song is Tomorrow Never Dies by Sheryl Crow. Ooh, neither here nor there theme song. Sheryl Crow doesn't have the voice for this song. You can literally hear her straining to hit the notes in the song. Media mogul Elliot Carver plans to use a stolen encoder to start a war between China and the United Kingdom and boost ratings for his cable networks. Carver's wife, Paris, is an ex-girlfriend of Bond's, and her assistance costs her her life. Spoiler. Bond must fight Carver with the help of Chinese spy Wai Lin. Very straightforward. It's basically Bond and the Bond girl taking down the Bond villain. That's all this movie is. But what I like about this movie is that it pushes the boundaries in terms of Bond with a very good Bond girl. She is the second Asian Bond girl, but you can count her as the first Asian Bond girl because Kissy Suzuki in You Only Live Twice, the movie was so racist, you can't really tell if they were being genuine with choosing an Asian Bond girl, whereas this time, Wai Lin, played by Michelle Yeoh, is definitely the Bond girl, and she can definitely kick ass in this movie. She's got great martial arts skills, as evidenced by her role in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. And I think she makes one of the better Bond girls ever, actually. On the other hand, Elliot Carver is a one-dimensional and stupid villain. He's got a very stupid plan to take over the media. And I suppose this movie came out because the media was, you know, it was a period where the media was very big in the world. He's a stupid villain. He doesn't do anything for me. And the whole plot is, like I said, it's just pretty much straightforward. But it's got a good Bond girl, and it's Pierce Brosnan. Number 10 is Dr. No, 1962. Sean Connery as Bond. Sean Connery as the first James Bond. Directed by Terence Young, the villain is Dr. Julius No, played by Joseph Wiseman. The Bond girl is Honey Rider, played by Ursula Andres. The song is instrumental. It's the Bond theme song. Bond is sent to Jamaica to investigate the death of MI6 agent John Strangways. He finds his way to Crab Key Island, where the mysterious Dr. No awaits. Alright, this is a very good movie. It is a good movie. It's the first Bond movie. It's the first Sean Connery. It's the first everything. It does, however, have an underwhelming plot. The plot is not very compelling. It's not very interesting. It has an underwhelming villain. I mean, when you get to see Dr. No, you're like, oh, shit, that's Dr. No! And then all he does is have dinner with Bond and then sit at a control station and press some buttons. That's all he does. And I don't really understand what his plot is in this movie. Like, what is his master plan? I don't really know what it is. It involves some rocket launch and it involves some, like, uranium or radioactive thingy. And I don't really know what the whole thing is. It's a very muddled kind of plot, but it is an iconic movie. It is, because when you watch this movie now, after all the years of Bond, you actually get a sense of how iconic this Bond movie is and what this movie did for the franchise. Because I'm pretty sure when this movie was first made, yeah, they might have thought that, yeah, we're going to make a couple more because we've got a lot of Ian Fleming novels to adapt. But they definitely did not know how big James Bond would get from Dr. No. And so, yeah, and Dr. No, so you could almost say that it's an honorary number 10, which I don't really like to say because the movie is still good. It's just not great. Moving on to the top 10. All right, so we are already safely now in the good section of my list. Remember I said that was the good section, and then after this is the outstanding section. So we're safely now in the good section of this list. At number 9 is The World Is Not Enough. 1999, Pierce Brosnan is James Bond. Directed by Michael Apted, the villain is Renard, played by Robert Carlyle, one of the better Bond villains, in my opinion. The Bond girl is Dr. Christmas Jones, played by Denise Richards, one of the worst Bond girls, in my opinion. The theme song is The World Is Not Enough by Garbage. Renard, a terrorist who feels no pain and is slowly dying due to a bullet lodged in his brain. That, by the way, is a very interesting idea. Like, whoever thought of putting a bullet in his brain, probably Ian Fleming. That was a great idea. It's a genius, because I love the idea that there's a bullet in his brain and it's killing off his nerves. It's killing off his nervous system so he can't feel pain, but it's also gradually killing him. I think that's a wonderful little personal time bomb that Renard has. So with a bullet in his brain, he attempts to assassinate billionaire Robert King. Bond is assigned to protect his daughter Electra King and must find Renard with the help of Valentin Sukovsky and Christmas Jones. Like I said, one of the worst Bond girls. Denise Richards is not a good actor. She makes a very irritating Bond girl, and she's way too hot to be a scientist, so it's all wrong. One of the best villains, though, because I really like Renard. I really like Robert Carlyle. I like the way he plays this character. He's a very imposing figure, but he's also very sympathetic. He's also very pathetic. And I think that works for his character. I think it works for the movie. It's got an interesting plot. I think Sophie Marceau in this movie is also brilliant. And this movie doesn't get enough credit. I think there's a great boat chase that starts the movie. The theme song by Garbage is wonderful. And there's an interesting plot of raising petrol prices. I think that is way more profound and way more interesting than some of the ridiculous Bond plots like Moonraker and A View to a Kill. So yeah, The World Is Not Enough is quite an underrated Pierce Brosnan Bond movie, and it's quite obviously my second favorite Pierce Brosnan Bond movie. Number 8 is... dun dun dun... Spectre! 2015, Daniel Craig is James Bond, directed by Sam Mendes. The villain is Franz Oberhauser, played by Christoph Waltz. The Bond girl is Dr. Madeleine Swann, played by Lea Seydoux. The theme song is The Writings on the Wall by Sam Smith. A cryptic message from Bond's past sends him on a trail to uncover a sinister organization. While M battles political forces to keep the Secret Service alive, Bond peels back the layers of deceit to reveal the terrible truth behind Spectre. I'm not going to say anything about this movie. If you want to know my thoughts on this movie, go listen to my Spectre episode. It's on iTunes, it's on YouTube, go listen to that. Spectre is number 8. Moving on, number 7, The Spy Who Loved Me, 1977, Roger Moore is James Bond, directed by Lewis Gilbert. The villain is Karl Stromberg, played by Kurt Jurgens. The Bond girl is Anya Amasova, played by Barbara Bach. The theme song is Nobody Does It Better by Carly Simon, and this is one of the worst James Bond songs because it's a good song, but it's a stupid love ballad that doesn't fit James Bond at all. British and Russian submarines have been hijacked, oh no, and the two countries come together, sending 007 and Russian agent Anya Amasova to track down a stolen microfilm and investigate. The tension rises as Amasova discovers that Bond had killed her lover in the course of duty. Bond needs to get Amasova on his side as a life insurance policy against her threat to kill him when their mission is over. This is by far and away the best Roger Moore James Bond movie. I think a lot of people say The Man with the Golden Gun is Roger Moore's best. I think The Spy Who Loved Me is the best. You know, there's a neat villain lair, which is underwater. There is a neat villain in Karl Stromberg. He's got an interesting scheme. And I think this whole movie just works. It's the least comical Roger Moore movie. It's the least ridiculous. It's the least preposterous. It's the most grounded Roger Moore movie. It's got the great Bond car and the Lotus Esprit, which is a bit out there because it turns into a submarine, but the way it turns into a submarine is pretty cool. And if you can just, you know, kind of forgive the science for a while, you can actually realize that it's a fun car and a pretty enjoyable movie. So now I think it's time to dabble in the outstanding section of my list. Some of the titles blur in and out. I could consider The Spy Who Loved Me in the outstanding section. I'm just saying this now because I'm realizing it. Number 6. We're reaching the top of this list already. And yeah, I'm doing it in less than an hour, so success. Number 6, License to Kill, 1989. Timothy Dalton is James Bond. Directed by John Glenn, the villain is Fran Sanchez, played by Robert Davi. The Bond girls, and I'm saying Bond girls for this movie because I think there are two equal Bond girls in this movie. And it's a bit sad that James Bond ended up choosing the white choice. The white choice is Pam Bouvier, played by Carrie Lowell. And the non-white choice is Lupe Lamora, played by Talisa Soto. And in a recent article by Hooked on Film, because in honor of Bond Week, Hooked on Film released the top 5 Bond girls, and I actually chose Lupe Lamora as my number one choice. I think for me, she is the best Bond girl because she is unbelievably pretty, played by Talisa Soto. She's got perfect skin. She's got perfect skin color. She is a very hardy and tough Bond girl. You know, she's been ill-treated by the villain, Fran Sanchez. And she genuinely loves Bond. And she is a great Bond girl because she's not wimpy. She's not always a damsel in distress. She's in distress, but she's able to handle herself well. And I just feel sorry for her because her love was spurned by James. Yeah. The theme song is License to Kill by Gladys Knight. Bond and Felix Leiter catch drug lord Franz Sanchez during a raid in Miami, but Sanchez escapes after bribing DEA agent Ed Killifer. Sanchez kills and rapes Leiter's wife, and Leiter is fed to a shark, losing a leg. Bond must infiltrate and destroy Sanchez's operation and avenge the death of Leiter's wife. Best Bond girl love triangle by far. And I like this movie because it brings the evil scheme back down to ground level. So I'm talking about seeing this movie in the course of watching all the James Bond movies. Because with Roger Moore especially, you know, you had all these ridiculous... I'm saying ridiculous so many times in this episode, but you did have so many ridiculous evil schemes by the villains in the Roger Moore movies to take over the world and world domination, and I've got my evil lair, I've got my endless stream of henchmen with machine guns. License to Kill brings the villain back down to ground level. All he wants to do is become a billionaire, and he's a drug lord who wants to become a billionaire. That's his goal, and it's a very refreshing goal when watching License to Kill in the midst of a James Bond marathon. And that's particularly why I really enjoy this movie. It's a real big step up from Timothy Dalton's first outing as Bond. It's got the great Bond girl, it's got the good villain, and it's got a very interesting plot. It's a well-made movie, and I enjoyed it. Number 5 is... Dun, 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 dun. GoldenEye, 1995. Pierce Brosnan is James Bond. Directed by Martin Campbell. The villain is Alec Trevelyan, played by Sean Bean. The Bond girl is Natalia Simonova, played by Isabella Skorupko. The theme song is GoldenEye by Tina Turner, in my opinion, the best James Bond theme song because it encapsulates all that James Bond is. The song is synonymous with espionage, and I think the song is just outstanding. Tina Turner sings it with so much seductive power that this, for me, is the best James Bond theme song. Xenia on the top and Colonel Orumov, okay, whatever, hijack a special helicopter that is immune to electromagnetic pulse. The pair then go to a Soviet bunker that is the control base for the GoldenEye satellite weapons. They kill the staff and destroy the base with an electromagnetic pulse from one of the satellites, themselves protected by the helicopter. Bond must investigate the attack. I think Xenia on the top, who is played by Famke Janssen in this movie, is outstanding. She is this completely psychotic chick who kills people by suffocating them with her thighs, which sounds ridiculous, but it's pretty insane. And this movie is Brosnan at his best. GoldenEye is one of those Bond movies that you can just sit back and thoroughly enjoy for being a thorough, true Bond movie. You get James Bond being very suave, very convincing in the action scenes. And he's also very human. He says a lot of things in this movie that you would never catch Sean Connery, Roger Moore, George Lazenby, or Timothy Dalton ever saying. He opens up about the reasons why he's James Bond. He opens up about how he's able to kill people and still retain his sanity. It really brings the character of James Bond back down to the ground level, and I think that's what makes Pierce Brosnan's James Bond one of the better James Bonds and makes GoldenEye number 5 on my list. So I think for me, GoldenEye marks the entrance to the outstanding section of my list. So we're now in the top 5. Number 4. Bum, bum, bum. We are getting close to number 1. And I think if you know your James Bond movies and you know the movies that I have not mentioned yet, you can kind of figure out what my top 4 are going to be. But just hold your thoughts. Number 4 is Skyfall. 2012, Daniel Craig is James Bond, directed by Sam Mendes. The villain is Raoul Silva, played by Javier Bardem. The Bond girl, now it's questionable. A lot of people say the Bond girl is Miss Moneypenny, but that's not true. We all know that the Bond girl is M, because M is the Bond girl in this movie. She kicks ass, she follows Bond around, and I think it's interesting that they finally made M, Judi Dench's M, a Bond girl. The theme song is Skyfall by Adele, one of the better James Bond theme songs. James Bond's loyalty to M is tested as her past comes back to haunt her. As MI6 itself comes under attack, Bond must track down and destroy the threat, no matter how personal the cost. This is, without doubt, I'm putting my foot down, this is the best-looking Bond movie. The cinematography by Roger Deakins is completely outstanding. There are so many breathtaking shots in this film. You can really sit down and enjoy this movie with the sound off. You can mute the volume of this movie and just enjoy the visuals. It's a great-looking Bond movie. There's a wonderful story. I like the fact that Bond's childhood is kind of prodded and opened up for us to see. I do like the reveal of the meaning of Skyfall. I'm not going to say what Skyfall means in case you haven't seen Skyfall, but I do like the reveal of Skyfall. I don't really like the fact that the second half, the climax of the movie, is the adult version of Home Alone. I think they could have been a bit more original with the climax. With that said, it's not something I can change. It's still a very enjoyable film. It's full of adrenaline. It's highly paced. And it's a very suave film. I think this is one of Daniel Craig's suaver releases as Bond. If I had to say anything bad about this film besides the climax, it would be that I was kind of underwhelmed by Javier Bardem as Silva. I don't think he made a very imposing and scary villain. But it's still a great film. I mean, it's number 4 on my list. It is a very, very good Bond movie. Number 3. From Russia with Love. 1963, Sean Connery's James Bond, directed by Terence Young. The villain, okay, there are multiple villains in this movie. There's Rosa Klebb, who's played by Lotte Yelena. There is Blofeld, you don't really get to see his face. And there's Red Grant, played by Robert Shaw, whom all of you will remember from Jaws. The Bond girl is Tatiana Romanova, played by Daniela Bianchi. The theme song is From Russia with Love by Matt Monroe. When MI6 gets a chance to get their hands on a Lecter decoder, Bond is sent to Turkey to seduce the beautiful Tatiana and bring back the machine. With the help of Karim Bey, Bond escapes on the Orient Express, but might not make it off alive. This is a great... I just saw this movie day before yesterday. This, in all honesty, is a magnificent James Bond movie. It unites everything we love about Bond. You know, the cars, the women, the gadgets, the villains, the exotic locations, everything about James Bond without the gimmickry, without the silly, you know, gadget-filled car, without all the humdrum of the villain and the villain's lair and the henchman and all that nonsense. It still gets the job done without the usual Bond gimmickry. James Bond and Tatiana, they seem like a real couple. I think Daniela Bianchi portrays Tatiana Romanova very casually, very convincingly. She's a very playful girl. She's a very normal, ordinary girl. And we actually care about them as a couple. I think we do care about their fate as a couple, their destinies as a couple. There are great fight scenes in this movie. The fight scene on the train with Red Grant is just outstanding. So well choreographed, so well shot, so well lit. There's so much on the line. And Red Grant just makes a wonderful villain. I mean, Robert Shaw makes a fantastic villain. This is just, it's a wonderful movie. this, I'm not even kidding, From Russia With Love, a lot of people might not like it because it doesn't have the Bond gimmickry that, a lot of people are used to. But in terms of Bond being Bond, Sean Connery, this is a wonderful film. Okay, so I'm now in my top two. There are two films left. If you've been keeping track, you should be able to know what the two films are. I guess the only question you can ask yourself now is, which one is number one? I'm going to spoil it right now by telling you that number two is Goldfinger. 1964. Sean Connery is James Bond, directed by Guy Hamilton. The villain is Ulrich Goldfinger, played by Gert Frobe, voiced by Michael Collins. The Bond girl is Pussy Galore, horrible name, played by Honor Blackman. The theme song is Goldfinger by Shirley Bassey, my second favorite theme, James Bond theme song. The Bank of England has detected The Bank of England has detected an unauthorized leakage of gold from the country, and Bond is sent to investigate. The suspect is one Ulrich Goldfinger, the richest man in the country. Bond catches Goldfinger cheating at cards with the assistance of Jill Masterson, who is killed and painted gold in revenge, one of the most famous James Bond shots, when there's a naked body painted in gold on the bed. Bond must foil his plots while avoiding the deadly Korean odd job. This is an immensely iconic Bond movie. I mean, this is the Bond movie that most people will list as their favorite because it establishes all the traits and all the codes and conventions that we come to expect from a James Bond movie. If you compare it to what I said about From Russia With Love, that can be a bad thing because it takes away the humility of James Bond and From Russia With Love, and it adds all the gimmickry that we will later know in the James Bond movies. But this is still a great entertainment. There is a great villain. There's a great plot. There's an interesting Bond girl in Pussy Galore. You know, she's more complex than a lot of people would think. She is more complex than her name would suggest. Connery has never looked better as James Bond. It's just, and I don't want to use this word all the time, but this is truly an iconic Bond movie. Sean Connery is suave in this film. I love the fact that there's gold everywhere. I mean, Ulrich Goldfinger is the first man with the golden gun. He is. He has a golden revolver in this movie. He is the original man with the golden gun. And the movie still holds up today. This is another movie that I saw a couple of days ago, and it still holds up. It's a truly great Bond movie. I don't think I need to sing its praises anymore. It's number two on my list, and that means there's only space for one. Number one on my list of the Bond movies ranked from worst to best. So, therefore, my favorite Bond movie of all time is Casino Royale. 2006, Daniel Craig as James Bond, directed by Martin Campbell, who also directed GoldenEye, fun fact. The villain is Le Chiffre, played by Mads Mikkelsen. The Bond girl is Vesper Lynn, played by Eva Green. Not one of my favorite Bond girls. I'm not a big Eva Green fan. She irritates me. The theme song is You Know My Name by Chris Cornell, one of the better songs. Casino Royale opens with Bond gaining his 00 status by killing two enemy agents and earning his license to kill. Bond must win a high-stakes poker game against terrorist financier Le Chiffre to bankrupt him so that he will be murdered by his bankers. This is the best James Bond movie. It has the best title sequence. I love the fact that there are no naked girls in the title sequence. It's so freshly animated that when I watched it for the first time, I was like, crap. This title sequence is amazing. Like GoldenEye, this movie revolutionizes the Bond franchise. GoldenEye revolutionized the Bond character and really opened up his emotions to the world. This movie revolutionizes the whole franchise. It brings the entire franchise, you know, back down to earth. And it kind of returns the franchise to the period of From Russia With Love. You know, there are no silly gadgets in this movie. There's no lair. There are no henchmen. There's no ridiculous plot. It's a very, very subdued, again, I'm going to say this phrase, it's a very, very down-to-earth movie. It grounds the character of James Bond. It makes him a very interesting Bond because he's very flawed. He makes so many mistakes in this movie because he's just earned his 00 status. And we get to see the rugged side of James Bond for the first time. I mean, Timothy Dalton, I think, was the closest to being a rugged James Bond. But Daniel Craig, he goes all the way. I mean, he really goes all the way in this movie to make himself a rugged James Bond. And he succeeds. He really succeeds. That opening Parker sequence is amazing. And what this movie does, it also, it humanizes the villain. It makes Lachif a very human villain, which is something that most of the James Bond movies didn't do. I mean, Goldfinger, yeah, he's a great villain, but he's not a very human villain. He's still this larger-than-life character who has this, you know, crazy plan to be rich. But Lachif in this movie is a very human villain. He has fears, he has worries, he has thoughts, he has his shortcomings, and yet he's also imposing, he's menacing, he's unforgivable, and unforgiving. He is an all-rounded villain, and he's played superbly by Mads Mikkelsen. There's great action in this movie. There is great tension in the poker scenes. A lot of people thought the poker scenes went on too long. I really disagree. I think the poker scenes in this movie are for me, the highlight of this movie, because there is so much interplay between Bond and Lachif during these poker scenes that it adds so much tension, even though all they're doing is playing cards. And it doesn't hurt that I'm a poker fan. So I just took a lot of pride and a lot of joy in seeing the poker scenes. Yeah, Casino Royale is hands down my favorite Bond movie. I think it is the best Bond movie. I didn't want to choose Goldfinger, you know, just because everyone would be expecting me to choose Goldfinger. But in all honesty, Goldfinger is my second favorite Bond movie because it is so fantastic. That's it. That does it for my Bond list. I have just reached the 1 hour mark. I'm looking at my timer right now. I've just reached the 1 hour mark. So I have failed. I have failed in my quest to do this in under an hour. But I don't care. It was fun. It was fun talking about the James Bond movies and what I think, you know, the ordering of my movies was. Just to recap, I'm just going to do a quick recap for you guys. At number 24, right at the bottom, is A View to a Kill. Number 23 is Moonraker. Number 22 is For Your Eyes Only. 21, Diamonds Are Forever. 20, Octopussy. 19, Die Another Day. 18, Thunderball. 17, Quantum of Solace. 16, On Her Majesty's Secret Service. 15, The Living Daylights. 14, Live and Let Die. 13, You Only Live Twice. 12, The Man with the Golden Gun. 11, Tomorrow Never Dies. 10, Dr. No. 9, The World Is Not Enough. 8 is Spectre. 7 is The Spy Who Loved Me. 6 is A License to Kill. 5 is GoldenEye. 4 is Skyfall. 3 is From Russia with Love. 2 is Goldfinger. And 1 is Casino Royale. That does it for this special episode of The Critical Reel, where I ranked all 24 Bond movies from worst to best. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you had fun listening to me ramble on about Bond and being all sanctimonious as to what I think the best Bond movie is. Coming up, don't forget to stay tuned to my regular programming. I've still got a movie that I'm going to dissect and review on Monday or Tuesday, my usual episode release. Don't forget to follow me on social media. You can like my Facebook page at facebook.com/thecriticalreel. Follow me on Twitter at thecriticalreel. Visit hookedonfilm.com.au. And don't forget, if you want to have a chat with me about this list, if your list is completely different from mine, message me on Facebook, message me on Twitter, let me know what you thought. You can even email me at zach@thecriticalreel.com. Email me, let me know what you thought about this episode, what you thought about my list. I would love to hear from you guys. And we can have a chat about what your ranking of the James Bond movies would be, what your favorite Bond movie is. Let me know. I hope you've enjoyed listening to this podcast episode. Until next time, until episode 17 of The Critical Reel, where I will be hinting in the upcoming days what movie I'm going to be dissecting and reviewing. Don't stop watching movies till I've completely messed it up. Don't stop watching movies. Watch movies till the day you die. I always mess up this outro. Every time I sign off, I mess it up. I think I have to change my signing out phrase because it's not working for me. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Stay safe, guys. Watch movies till the day you die. There you go. That's so much better.